Yeah, so, and he's actually thinking about trying to escape, but it's not really all that possible. But the fact that he's actually even thinking about it, the cops that are assigned, not only is he sent to this deepest Siberia, but he's issued with an individual cop whose sole job is to make sure he doesn't escape, to actually keep an eye on him, a relatively close eye on him. And this cop gets wind that Stalin's thinking of even trying to escape. So what they do is they send him even further north, like not a fast amount further, but even further north to an even more remote, tiny little place called, I'm probably pronouncing this wrong, but called Kugara, I think it's pronounced. And that is really the ends of the earth almost. There's like eight families that live in this tiny little hamlet, and they're all sort of ultra impoverished, eking out whatever they can from the ground. Just going hungry a lot, a lot. They say like one day we would have like a broth made of the last turnip or whatever, and the following day we would, the only thing we'd have to eat is God's grace. In other words, nothing. And Stalin's sent up there with an individual set of eyes on him. So they've obviously realised this, they're not going to muck about with him anymore. This idea of capture, escape, that game is over. And I suppose at some point Stalin accepts it, I suppose, because what happens over the next few, like 3 years or whatever, he's up there, is that he accepts the Siberian nomadic hunter-gatherer, like wild outdoorsman thing into his heart. He embraces it. He ends up like learning loads of techniques for fishing and hunting and stuff off the local tribesmen, like these indigenous Tunguska, like reindeer herdsmen type dudes, and he learns loads off them, loads, like all survival techniques and things. And you have to be, again, a hard character to deal with that, like the solitudes and the darkness and the struggle for everything, every tiny thing. I don't know if you ever watched Survival, like Ray Mears or whatever, when they do, or Bear Grylls, when they do Arctic stuff. Oh, it's hellacious, really. And to live it for months or years on end. So Stalin was already a man of steel, if you like, a streetwise fighter turned gangster turned terrorist. And then you throw him into a years-long survival ordeal that he passes, in the end passes with flying colours. Yeah, out the other end of that is going to come a hardened individual on many levels. No, apparently he spent loads of times, like, he would just go off for, like, weeks on end into the frozen tundras and onto frozen lakes and fish and catch massive sturgeons and stuff on his own. So, yeah, he actually became good at surviving up there. Something else went down when he was up there, which is worth mentioning, because the pattern has always been that he would end up sleeping with like the people that put him up, either the landlady or if the landlady's daughter is prettier, usually her. This time, when they send him into that town, even further, that hamlet, even further north, where there's only like eight families there, he shacks up with one of the families, and he starts a sexual liaison with the daughter of that family, but she's 13. Her name's Lydia, and yeah, it just sort of openly is having an affair with her, and her family don't like it. I mean, they're all sharing one sort of open room, apparently, one sort of dungy, fuggy open room, and of course they would have some privacy for when they needed privacy, but it's out in the open, basically, that he's sleeping with this 13-year-old. And there were laws against it, but it was, fairly common that a 14 or 15 or 16-year-old girl get pregnant. Oh, it's still fairly common now in teenage pregnancies, not millions of teenage pregnancies, but it's still totally not okay that he's sleeping with this 13-year-old Lydia. Oh, and he gets her pregnant. But he'll just go off on, a fishing trip for months on end. Oh, the guy, the policeman that was sent to keep his eyes on Stalin the whole time. After a while, Stalin sends a petition to like the authorities back home saying, I want a different cop because this guy's invading my privacy too much. There's one anecdote when the cop bursts in on him, apparently, with his 13-year-old, and Stalin goes mental and, like, chases him all around, and after that says, I insist on someone else coming to guard me. And amazingly, the authorities okay it, and they send him a different guy. And this different guy, the new one, is just totally more lax. It's like not keeping a close eye on Stalin at all. For example, one time Stalin disappears off into the forests for actually months on end. And the guy said, oh, I was just following the rumour that he hadn't actually escaped. He's just on a really long hunting trip. And he was. And years later, years and years later, like when Stalin was in the Kremlin, he still said, I'll always thank that guy for being cool, basically, for not being such a douchebag about everything. And that guy, that cop replacement that was sort of a bit more lax, at one point during the terror was accused of being a kulak, in other words, a peasant that owned property, who, you know, you get sent to a gulag for that. And they think that he was almost certainly spared personally by Stalin because of that. Like, so there's one, I've seen these death lists they would have, thousands of names sometimes. And as I mentioned before, Stalin might put a note, I want more. But every now and again, really, really rarely, but every now and again he'd cross a name out and save that person. So anyway, he gets this Lydia pregnant, she has the baby dies in infancy almost straight away. I mean, perhaps not surprising up there, but you know, only the strongest babies live. So Stalin's sort of off the hook in that sense for that. So he gets her pregnant again. She just gets pregnant again. And remember, so this is World War One started at this time. Stalin spends all of World War One, basically, as far as Russia's concerned, safely, in inverted commas, up in Siberia, you know, far away from the fighting. He's spared all that fighting. He is out of the loop, though. I mean, really out of the loop. He asks some of the leading lights, like Lenin and Zinoviev or Kamenev, these top boys, he asks them to help him out and to keep telling him the news and stuff, but they sort of don't very much. They do send him a bit of money and they do correspond with him a bit, but they've got bigger fish to fry. He's basically out of the picture. They can't help him much. But he doesn't ever forget that as well. He sort of holds it against a lot of them that they were could have done more for him and didn't. But yeah, he's totally out of the loop. World War One's going on, which he obviously has got no power over, can't do anything with that, and is embroiled in like an Arctic sex scandal, basically. So Stalin spent so long up in Siberia in the end that it really seemed to have affected him. He sort of took it entirely on board as part of his character, and, you know, made him even more icy, if you like. One of the things that actually happened up there towards the end of his term in deepest Siberia is that a couple of people came up to visit him. He was, as I said, he had a replacement cop that was to watch him, and he was a bit more lax, and Stalin was actually able to, he wasn't entirely confined to just the ultra northern hamlet. He was actually able to travel a little bit around. And anyway, at one point, he's visited in 1915. He's visited by Kamenev, who's been sent to exile as well, who's one of the leading lights. And there's a story from this time that often gets mentioned in histories or biographies of Stalin, and I guess I'll have to mention it. I've heard it attributed to a completely different time in Stalin's life as well, in the 30s, but I think it's from this point in 1915. They are having a dinner one night, and there's lots of, you know, exiles, Bolsheviks sitting around, and Kamenev asks the group what they think is their greatest pleasure in life, and people give different answers, and like really some people apparently give your classic Marxist answer, saying my greatest pleasure in life is the progress of dialectical materialism towards the workers' paradise, something that you'd think that they would want to hear, you know, real commie stuff. But apparently Stalin thinks about it for a minute and says, my greatest pleasure is to choose one's victim, prepare one's plans minutely, slake an implacable vengeance, then go to bed. There's nothing sweeter in the world. if that quote is true, which is, I think it is, I don't think there's any doubt you said it. It's just a bit mental, isn't it? Completely in the realm of a psycho. Who says that, really? I mean, it's also a bit perfect because he went on to, you know, act like that. But, yeah, anyway. So while he's up there, as I mentioned before, he got that Lydia pregnant, and but the baby died, but then he got her pregnant again, and that baby did live. But he never, he again, when it came his time to leave, he did just leave, and he never went back and had any sort of, he didn't have any connection with the child. And Simon Montefiore writes, quote, "Stalin never contacted her," meaning Lydia. "He was utterly unfettered by paternal feelings or even sentimental curiosity. Stalin abandoned his son, but Turukhansk somehow made him more of a Russian. Perhaps Siberia froze some of the Georgian exoticism out of him. He brought the self-reliance, vigilance, fragility and solitude of the Siberian hunter with him to the Kremlin." End quote. That puts it more perfectly than I could say. And as I mentioned before, Molotov was one of the few that actually went through the whole process with him from those early days, those early pre-World War One days, all the way through to Stalin's death in the early 50s. And Molotov was on record as saying, quote, "A little piece of Siberia remained lodged in Stalin for the rest of his life," quote. And I think that's true. I definitely think that seems to ring true when you know everything that he went on to do.